Since the dawn of humanity, countless cultures around the world have held prophecies and tales foretelling a time when an epic final battle between the forces of light and dark would destroy the Earth, and where the victorious forces would be given the power to become the rulers over a new reality. And though to many this battle may seem like the legendary stuff of stories, there are those who believe that the final battle is upon us, and that Armageddon has indeed begun. However, it is essential here to understand that, contrary to popular belief, Armageddon is not a battle that can be fought and won on the battlefields of man. But rather, the true Armageddon can only be won in the hearts and souls of humanity. For though it is possible that we will see an escalating conflict rise across the face of the Earth in the days and months to come, it is essential to realize that these external battles are only a reflection of the conflict that is raging within the hearts and souls of so many across the world today. For in accordance with the universal law, as above, so below, as within, so without, the increasing tensions that are rising on our global stage are surfacing in an effort to help us recognize the conflict that is taking place in the consciousness of each one of us. For today there are many who are awakening to the truth that humanity has lost its way. People all over the world are beginning to realize that the race of man is walking an unsustainable path, and that our governments, whom we have entrusted with the care of our planet and its populace, are willfully destroying the Earth and its inhabitants in their tireless conquest for war and wealth. However, because we have become so dependent on the existing system and structures for our comfort and survival, many people feel powerless to step off the path and live a life that is in alignment with the truth that is growing in their hearts. For they fear that if they remove their support from the system that they have come to depend on, that threat to the system will then result in a threat to their own survival. And so, ironically, we have a growing number of people around the world who are denying the truth of their hearts for fear of the possible threat it may pose to their comfort and survival in the present. While these same people are beginning to realize that their continuing support of the existing system along its current path will at some point in the not-too-distant future lead to the inevitable destruction of the planet. And thus, in accordance with universal law, as long as more and more humans continue to allow this conflict to rage in their hearts by denying the truth it is demanding to be acknowledged, the external manifestations of this inner conflict will continue to grow in intensity in our outer world until they eventually lead us to the final battle of Armageddon and the breaking of the world. Thus we may see that humanity's current damned if we do, damned if we don't scenario is requiring us to make a leap of faith, whereby those who see the truth of humanity's current self-destructive path are urged to take the courageous leap into the unknown, by acting according to the truth of their hearts and facing the unknown consequences of their actions, so that they may avoid the certain destruction that they see is coming. And it is because so few are able to make that leap of faith that will allow them to follow their hearts and free themselves from their attachment to the existing system on which they have come to depend, that at the close of every major world cycle, when we need it the most, we are given the blessed battle of Armageddon, by which the world as we know it may be broken so that it can be rebuilt. For it is only by breaking the world and its existing systems that those humans who felt powerless to make the leap for themselves to a new way of being are then given the push that they so desperately need to free themselves from their dependence on the crumbling system that no longer supports them, and thus be freed to discover a new way together. While the necessary destruction that comes with Armageddon and the breaking of the world also serves the essential role of eradicating the foundations of the old system, so that we can then create an entirely new foundation for an evolved way of seeing and being in the world. Thus it is the evolutionary importance of these endings that is being referred to by the speaker in the book of Ecclesiastes when he says, "Better the end of anything than its beginning." For in our spiraling evolution, each end brings us to a new beginning that is on a higher plane of our evolutionary journey. And though many will discount the stories of Armageddon and other such tales of the days of tribulation as mere myth, the reason that these stories of the past live and continue to be told in cultures throughout the world, as if prophesying what is to come, is because these events serve an essential role in facilitating humanity's spiritual evolution. And therefore, as long as that purpose needs to be fulfilled, there will always be an Armageddon and an end of days. For as long as humanity has and will ever need that push to free itself from its outmoded systems and beliefs, one can be certain that Armageddon is sure to come. If one can consider that the breaking of the world through the event of Armageddon plays an essential role in our spiritual evolution by giving those who feel powerless to let go of a system that they have come to depend on the necessary push that will allow them to free themselves into a new way of being, then one may also come to see that there is an essential evolutionary role that is fulfilled by the prophesied days of tribulation and the end of days, which assures that one day the end will come, so that we may experience a new beginning. For though many will not allow themselves to consider the end of the world as we know it, let alone the end of themselves, it is this essential part that dying to the old plays in allowing us to evolve into the new that is expressed in the story of the fiery phoenix, whose brilliant new being is born from the flames that she herself has set to her nest and previous self. And it is this concept of giving oneself over so that they may be raised to new spiritual heights that is reflected in the words of the Taoist sage Lao Tzu when he says in the Tao Te Ching, "If you want to be given everything, you must give up everything." And though there are many for whom our talk of tribulations and the end of days will arouse feelings of fear and anger, causing them to plug their ears and tune out our voices in an attempt to deny the inevitable truth that everything we see in the material world will eventually pass away, it is important to realize here that plugging one's ears to the truth does not make the truth go away. For in accordance with the liberating law of impermanence, all that has arisen will pass away. Because the constant state of our universe is that it is always changing, as destruction leads to creation, and life turns to death, then back to life again. And it is with this understanding of the universal law of impermanence that the true prophets from the earliest times have always foretold of war, death, pestilence, and famine that would lead to the downfall of many kings and great nations. For these prophecies telling of the destruction that accompanies the end of days have been given to us to help a forgetful humanity remember the impermanent nature of our material existence, so that we may then be inspired to seek and therefore find the greater spiritual purpose of our existence. And thus, in accordance with the prophecies, the physical events that typically occur during the end of days have been designed to escalate to such a dramatic level that most of humanity will be faced with the possibility of their own death and the loss of everything that they have worked to achieve in the material world, all of which would occur for the divine purpose of shifting humanity's perspective from the physical to the spiritual. For in a world where so many are living only for material achievement and survival, it will not be until that material reality is threatened with extinction, and when money and luxury fail to satisfy our needs for peace and comfort, that the majority of people will awaken to the worthlessness of material wealth and success, and thereby be inspired to seek inwards to find a new purpose and meaning for life. And in doing so, many will finally understand the words that they have been uttering for so long, which state that we are not human beings having a spiritual experience, but rather we are spiritual beings having a human experience. And thus, when the events of the end of days have served their divine purpose, when the death and destruction have shaken us from our material obsessions and given birth to our awareness of the eternal spirit that connects us all, we will learn to see the world in a new way, where even death and destruction, which humanity has denied and feared for so long, are seen to have a place and a purpose for which to be thankful and loving. It is this essential part that the end of days may play in assisting humanity's spiritual evolution by awakening us to the liberating law of impermanence and thus our spiritual purpose for being that ensures that one day an end will come. For it would appear that humanity is in need of a severe shaking to wake it up from the madness and illusions of its current existence. Thus, when the prophesied end of days reveals that everything we have come to believe and all that we have strived to achieve can be swept away in an instant, then may we realize the depth of foolishness that we have exhibited by living only to attain temporary material wealth, pleasure, and success for the self at the expense of our eternal spiritual soul. For there are many in today's world who are willingly selling their souls by taking jobs that contribute to the suffering of the earth and others in an effort to climb the ladder of success and survival, while others, whose occupations may seem more caring and considerate, are still so preoccupied with their individual pursuits of fun and fulfillment that they consistently turn a blind eye to the suffering that is caused by their willing participation in our self-destructive society. However, when the death and destruction that necessarily accompanies the end of days demonstrates the impermanence and thus the utter futility of striving only for material gains, and when amidst the collapse of the temporary material, we come to see the strength and beauty of the eternal spirit that remains, then each of us will have the opportunity to acknowledge the truth that our purpose for existence is not to attain wealth, pleasure, and success for the self in the material, but rather, we exist only to develop our spiritual selves and souls by learning to live a life that demonstrates a love and respect for all. This function of prophecy and the destruction that comes with the end of days, to awaken people to our spiritual purpose by demonstrating the worthlessness of material achievement, is revealed by the prophet Isaiah when he says, the walls of broad Babylon will be razed to the ground, her lofty gates set on fire. Worthless now is the thing for which peoples toiled. Nations wore themselves out for a mere nothing. And though there are some whose fear of death and the end of the world as we know it will cause them to continually deny the liberating law that all that has been made will be unmade, it is important to remember here that the end of our civilization is sure to come, as it always has. And we can choose to either run from it and eventually be overtaken, or to face the fact and thereby be freed from our fears. However, in our present world, many people are simply unwilling or unable to consider the inevitability of death or destruction. While anyone who speaks aloud the universal fact that the world as we know it will one day come to an end is labeled a conspiracy theorist, freak, or fearmonger. And yet what those accusing fail to understand is that it is only by contemplating the inevitable end of ourselves and the world as we know it that we can then prepare ourselves for the eventuality. For the end is sure to come someday. And for those who are unable to cope with this fact now, before it happens, how will they ever be able to deal with it when the time finally comes? It is understood in the Buddhist tradition that the quality of mind that one has at the moment of death determines the quality of mind that one will carry into the next life. And so, how better prepared might one be who has contemplated their own passing throughout their life than one who, for all their life, has run from the eventuality of death? Similarly, how better prepared might one be who is able to consider the inevitable end of the world as we know it, than one who out of fear is unable to consider what is sure to come? For one who chooses time and time again to close their ears and deny the fact that all things have their end, will prevent themselves from perceiving the subtle perspectives implied within the liberating law of impermanence, that have the power to free one from their deepest fears of death and destruction. While one who is willing to contemplate the nature of death will thereby awaken to new life. For the greater the fear one faces, the greater their liberation. And thus one who is freed from the fear of death is finally free to live. For it is the things that we fear most that will eventually set us free. As one who is able to face their fears rather than flee from them in fright is eventually liberated by the realization that there is, in fact, nothing to fear. For fear is an illusion created in the mind of the beholder. A reality that can be illustrated by considering the fact that fear does not come from the thing that frightens us, but rather, fear is created by the one who feels it. And the truth of this may be realized when one considers that there is an increasing number of people around the world who are able to consider the impermanent nature of themselves and our world without feeling fear. While others, upon considering such things, may become restless and terrified. Let this presentation then serve to show where our vibration sits. For just as those who can face such events without fear have proven, there is a way past fearing even the most unimaginable terrors. However, no one ever escapes their fears by running from them, for fear can only ever be overcome by facing it with love. Thus, one who is willing to face their fear of the end and use its existence as an opportunity to explore how they may then overcome that fear can then be liberated by the very thing they were afraid of and thereby make an evolutionary leap into a new way of seeing and being in the world. for one who is willing to contemplate the liberating law of impermanence will also come to see the freeing perspectives it implies. For when one comes to accept the fact that all things are impermanent, then they may also come to realize that the same is true of death. Indeed, there is even an end to every end. For every person, like every nation, has its purpose to serve and lessons to learn during its course of life. And when a spirit's work is fulfilled in the realms of flesh, it passes on to perform other tasks beyond our human sight. And with these mysterious new tasks complete, it will then pass on again to other tasks. And by, the soul's journey will continue until it attains the height of perfect life. And thus one may come to see that with the end of every end, there is always a new beginning. Similarly, one who faces their fear of the end and contemplates the liberating law of impermanence may then be further freed from the suffering one causes themselves as they face the ups and downs of life. For if one remembers that all things have their end, then they may prevent themselves the suffering that can be caused by creating an attachment to something that is certain to pass away. While one who is aware of the law of impermanence will also be able to bear the difficulties in life with relative peace and ease, knowing that whatever pain or discomforts they experience are sure to pass away as well. Thus we may see the essential role that the prophecies and the death and destruction that accompany the end of days play in assisting humanity's spiritual evolution by awakening us to the liberating law of impermanence. For it is through the act of facing the impermanence of our material existence that we may then awaken to the eternal nature of our spiritual path and purpose, and thereby be freed from our greatest fears. And by thus realizing the role that the end of days plays in awakening humanity to the truth of our spiritual nature, one may also realize that as long as humanity continues to believe solely in a material purpose for being, there will always be an Armageddon and an end of days. Another essential role that the end of days plays in assisting humanity's spiritual evolution, whose absolute necessity ensures that the days of tribulation are sure to come, is the opportunity that they provide to humble a humanity that has become so prideful of its achievements of the age that it has forgotten the will and existence of the creative intelligence known to many as God or Great Spirit. For it is the power that unmanageable strife has to encourage humanity to first realize its own limitations, and therefore awaken to the power and presence of the divine that is echoed in the words of the prophet Isaiah when speaking about the end of days. He says, "Mankind will be brought low, everyone will be humbled. The Lord of hosts has a day of doom in store for all that is proud and lofty, for all that is high and lifted up, for all lofty mountains and high hills, for every tall tower and every towering wall. Then will pride be brought low and loftiness humbled, and the Great Spirit alone will be exalted on that day." For it is clear in our world today that humanity is in need of a healthy helping of humble pie, so that in waking to its own limitations and false perceptions, it may then come to realize new truths and perceive the existence of a force far greater than itself. For the race of man has become willful and godless. Not only has it forgotten the existence of Great Spirit, but it no longer respects the spirit that resides in all living things. Rather, man in his confusion has come to falsely believe that he himself, through his material achievements of mind and metal, is the master of the heavens and the earth. In his pride and ignorance, man has cast aside the universal laws of the Creator and lives instead according to the false laws that he himself has devised. Illusory laws that have been put in place to justify and perpetuate the madness of our current self-obsessed existence. However, in accordance with the Creator's universal laws, an end of days approaches, which will serve an essential role in assisting humanity's spiritual evolution by humbling the prideful race of humans and awakening it to the powerful presence of the Creator, as well as the flimsy lies of the laws of man. For the inevitable destruction that comes with the end of days will serve to humble a prideful humanity by reminding us that despite all that we have achieved, there are still greater forces that can take it all away in an instant. And in so seeing all that humanity believed to be real erased in a breath, we will then be given the opportunity to further humble ourselves by acknowledging the futility and selfishness of living only to attain for the self, at the expense of the earth and others. For what so few people understand today is that it is the will of God that all beings should live in peace, harmony, and cooperation with one another. And therefore we may see that humanity, in its willful adherence to the false law of survival of the fittest, which encourages violent competition rather than respectful cooperation, is living in direct rebellion to the will of God. And thus what we are seeing in our world today is that man, in his increasing pride, spurred by the supposed success of his efforts to master the earth and its inhabitants, has come to think of himself as God. However, in accordance with the Creator's universal law of karmic returns, it will be through man's over-grasping efforts to employ weapons and technology to rule the heavens and the earth as God that he will finally be shown the limits of his power. For though the Creator, in his wisdom and mercy, has allowed the crimes of man to continue for a time, giving humanity the opportunity to awaken to and amend the pride and selfishness of its ways, in accordance with the universal law of karmic returns, which states that all that one puts out into the world will be returned to them in greater or equal portions, humanity will one day be made to pay for its actions. For a humanity that lives to take everything for itself will one day have everything taken away. Thus the profusion of suffering and selfishness put forth by humanity, along with the prideful demonstration of its willingness to toy with things it does not understand, ensures that one day the Great Spirit will arise from his slumber and unleash the end of days, whose breaking of the world will show humanity that it is indeed the Great Spirit and not material-minded man who is truly the master of the heavens and the earth, as revealed in the words of the prophet Jeremiah when speaking for the Creator. He says, "The end is coming on the four corners of the earth. I shall call you to account for your conduct and bring all your abominations on your own heads. I shall make you suffer for your conduct and the abominations that are in your midst. And then you will know that I am Lord." And though many among our prideful humanity will be quick to deny their involvement in shaping the state of the world, and will instead lay the blame at the feet of others, including God, and those that they would call the oppressors or orchestrators of our reality. It is essential to realize here that anyone who wishes to progress further on the spiritual path will be required to humble themselves and acknowledge the part that they themselves have played in making the world what it is. For it is in the act of humbling ourselves that we demonstrate the quality of our souls. For someone who has been caught stealing and yet denies that they are a thief, reveals their lack of remorse and unwillingness to change. While one who cannot acknowledge that each of us has played a part in making this world what it is, through our own selfish pursuits of pleasure, fun, and self-fulfillment, reveals also their own remorseless heart and reluctance to change. For if one is unable to humble oneself and acknowledge the parts of their being that are hindering their spiritual growth, how will they ever allow that growth to occur? Just as one who is not willing to empty their cup of what they believe is true will never allow for the inflowing of new wisdom and awareness. That said, there are still those who would deny the part that they themselves have played in creating our world of suffering and selfishness, and who would prefer instead to lay the blame at the feet of others. And though it seems reasonable that one would perceive themselves to be relatively blameless in a world where we are constantly made aware of the horrendous crimes of others, it is essential to understand here that one who looks for blame outside of oneself is lost. For what degree of pride and ignorance would spur one to lay the blame for what the world has become at the feet of the Creator? For all the Creator has done was in His infinite love and wisdom He gave to us a world, and the will to do with it what we would. And given the freedom to treat the earth either like a garden or a garbage dump, is it not our own actions and inaction that have made the world what it is today? And though others in their pride will look on in anger and shake their fists at the Creator because of the harm and suffering brought forth on man, one must remember that in accordance with the universal law of karmic returns, we always get what we deserve, as determined by the joy and pain we willfully impose on others. Thus one may see that the only reason that there is so much suffering in the world is because humanity has rebelled against the Creator's will that all should live in peace, and instead lives by the false law of man known as survival of the fittest. And in so doing, man, in his willingness to fight and cause the suffering of others, in an effort to attain success and survival for the self, ensures that that suffering will always come back on him. And thus, one who is willing to humble oneself will see that it is man's willingness to continually struggle and fight his way out of each successive challenge against each new opponent that makes he himself responsible for perpetuating the pain and suffering on earth. For this illusory law condoning the dog-eat-dog nature of our existence would have many amongst humanity believe that because one has the power to take and to tame, to condone and to condemn, to kill and to create, means that he should feel justified in doing so. However, what so few people understand today is that we are given the power and free will to do such things, not because we should do them, but so that we may demonstrate the quality of our souls through the choice of our actions. For one who has the power to overcome others and take what he wants for himself from the world demonstrates the quality of his soul when he chooses to use his power and gifts not to hurt others, but rather to help them. And herein lies another essential role that the end of days plays in facilitating our spiritual evolution. For not only does the death and destruction that accompanies the end of days serve the purpose of humbling humanity to the power and presence of the Creator, along with making atonement for the suffering we have caused by allowing us to feel it ourselves. But the experience of the end of days also serves to provide the necessary process of purification, whereby all false perceptions of ourselves and the world will be cleansed, so that we as individuals and a civilization may see, unobstructed, the true quality of our consciousness and spirit. For all around the world, there are those who believe that they are right, while others are wrong, that they are good, while others are evil. So too, there are those who have been blessed with an awareness of spirit in the world that has allowed them to see the selfishness, pride, ignorance, and hate that have brought the world to its current state of disease, destruction, and disrepair. However, many of these people, prideful of the perspectives that have been revealed to them, are either unwilling or unable to see and accept the fact that traces of these same self-serving qualities exist inside themselves. And so it is for this reason that at the close of every major world cycle, we are necessarily given the greater and lesser periods of cataclysm and cleansing that come with the end of days. So that amidst the death and destruction, the madness and the mayhem, each one of us may demonstrate the true quality of our souls, and reveal whether, when faced with death and the end of the world as we know it, we will do as we have always done and cling to our material self-obsession and fight for our lives, or will we demonstrate our willingness to evolve, and in love and humble faith, surrender ourselves to spirit. For though it is easy for one to say that faith is the way, peace is the way, love is the way, sacrifice is the way, it will not be until the climactic events of the end of days that we will see through our actions the truth of our soul's nature, and whether we will be able to act in accordance with our ideals of peace, selflessness, and love. Or will we, when faced with struggle and the need to attain for the physical self, demonstrate our nature by becoming godless with the godless, and thereby choosing to meet hate with hate, greed with greed, and fear with fear? Thus one may see that it is the clear demonstration of our soul's quality through the choice of our actions that has led many prophets to refer to the end of days by such terms as Judgment Day or the Day of Reckoning. However, contrary to what most people believe, we will be neither judged nor saved by the actions of some physical being of majestic stature living somewhere outside the dense material plane. But rather, in accordance with the universal law of karmic returns, each one of us will be responsible for our own judgment and salvation. For one who chooses to cling to their belief in the importance of the material during the chaos of the tribulations, and thereby demonstrate their willingness to fight for their life, will in their decision to cause others' suffering to attain for the self, ensure that that suffering comes back to them. For in the madness and chaos of the end of days, those who continually choose to meet greed with greed, and violence with violence, will cause that violence to continue to escalate to such a heightened level that person will be forced to either humble themselves and give up the fight, or they will continue to fight until it eventually leads to their destruction. And it will be thus, through one's own actions, that they will have served as their own judge, jury, and executioner. for one who chooses to cause the suffering of others to achieve personal gains, will reveal both to the person and to all of creation that their current level of consciousness still places all importance on the struggle for the success and survival of the temporary self in the material, over the evolution of the eternal soul in the spiritual. And thus it will be through one's own choice and their unwillingness to let go of the illusion of the self in the material that they themselves, and not some holy figure, will have determined that they should continue on with the suffering and struggles that are inherent in our material existence, until such a time that they are ready to relinquish the illusion of the self and move on to a more expanded perspective of existence. While on the other hand, there are those whose inner seeking throughout their lives has led them to an awareness that although our physical bodies and all we see will eventually pass away, there is a spirit that exists within all things that is eternal. Awakening to the eternal nature of the spirit self, these people have then come to see that our purpose in life is not to attain material success and survival of the temporary physical self, but rather, we live and die so that through our experiences we may contribute to the elevation of our eternal soul. And with this awareness, one may then come to see that the soul cannot be harmed by the words or deeds of others. For the only hindrance to one's spiritual growth is the harm one does oneself by causing the suffering of others. And so accordingly, the only way that one may raise their soul to the highest heights is not by striving to attain for the self, but by giving freely of oneself to others. Thus, in the interest of assisting the soul's ascent, it is far better to bear the physical pains and give what one can to others during the end of days than it would be to struggle and fight to attain for the self. Bringing to mind again the words of the Taoist sage Lao Tzu, who said, "If you want to be given everything, you must give up everything." Words also eloquently echoed by the Christ through Jesus when speaking of the narrow path that we may take to evolve beyond our current self-obsessed material existence. He said, "Whoever tries to save his life will lose his life. Whoever freely gives his life in serving life will save his life." And so, in accordance with the words of the sages of the age, we may see that the end of days serves an essential role in assisting humanity's spiritual evolution by giving us the opportunity to humble ourselves and thereby demonstrate our willingness to evolve beyond the belief that we are meant to hurt others to secure success and survival for the self, so that we may move into a new expression of humanity that is committed to the peace and freedom of all. For in accordance with the words of the Buddha, hate cannot be conquered by hate. Hate can only be conquered by love. However, ironically, these words themselves and the suggestion that people surrender the self and give up the fight to survive will be enough to start wars of their own. For within the body and beings of many, this truth will cause a conflict between the mind that knows it should fight and the heart that wants only to help. And it is the rising struggle between our hearts and minds amidst the increasing suffering of our external world that gives life to the great battle of Armageddon that rages within. And it is this inner conflict, caused by this sword of truth, that is being referred to by the Christ through Jesus when he said, "You must not think that I have come to bring peace to the earth. I have not come to bring peace, but a sword." For the presentation of this radical idea, that one should give up the fight, will not only cause a war inside, but it will stir up a conflict amongst the people who are not willing to surrender. For as Jesus said, "This leaven of truth which I have brought to men will stir the demons up, and nations, cities, families will be at war within themselves. The five that have been dwelling in a home of peace will be divided now, and two shall war with three. The son will stand against his sire, the mother and the daughter will contend, yea, strife will reign in every home. The self and greed and doubt will rage into a fever heat, and then, because of me, the earth will be baptized in human blood. But right is king. And when the smoke is cleared away, the nations will learn war no more. The Prince of Peace will come to reign." For those members of humanity who, amidst the death and destruction of the end of days, choose to surrender the self to spirit, will rise like phoenixes from the flames, thereby giving birth to a new humanity that honors and respects the oneness of life and the right to peace for all. And this restored humanity will once again be given the opportunity to live upon the earth, where it may continue its journey by learning the lessons that come, not by trying to rule over the earth as master, but by serving once more as the stewards of the earth, where the only law is love. Been warned that in the end of days, many false prophets will arise and deceive many people. However, in our current self-obsessed society, where so many are ignorant to the Creator's universal laws of impermanence and karmic returns, there is much confusion surrounding the idea of what makes a prophet false. And thus erroneously, in many cases, a prophet is called false when he contradicts the common beliefs of man. However, what so few people understand is that the prophets are given to humanity at the turning of the age, not to preach and reinforce the beliefs of humanity, but rather they come wielding the sword of truth, so that they may sever the people's bonds to the illusory laws of man, and thereby reveal the eternal truth of the words and laws of the Creator. Thus, the true prophets come not to comfort the nations, but rather they come to remind humanity of the impermanence of their material selves and civilizations, so that those who are willing to see the futility of struggling to attain for the self may then awaken to the spiritual purpose that is served by their life and death on earth. And it is for this reason that the prophets throughout all time, the prophets who preceded you and me, from earliest times have always foretold of war, famine, and pestilence for many lands and for great kingdoms. For it is the eternal truth of the message given to us by the prophets regarding the death and destruction that accompany the end of days, and the essential role that these days play in encouraging humanity's evolution from the material to the spiritual, that the Creator refers to when speaking to the prophet Isaiah. He says, "My spirit which rests on you, and my words which I have put in your mouth, will never fail you from generation to generation of your descendants, from now on forevermore. The Lord has said it." And it is the importance of these end-time prophecies, and the power they have to reveal the hearts of man, and thereby alter the prophecies themselves, that is expressed when the Creator says to the prophet Jeremiah, "Tell them everything that I charge you to say to them. Do not cut it short by one word. Perhaps they may listen, and everyone may turn back from their wicked ways. If they do, I shall relent and give up my plan to bring disaster on them for their selfish deeds." "Say to them, these are the words of the Lord. If you do not obey me, if you do not live according to the law I have set before you, and listen to the words of my servants, the prophets, who again and again I have been sending to you, though you have never listened to them, then I shall do to this house as I did to Shiloh, and make this city an object of cursing to all nations on earth." Having thus explored the essential role of the prophets, whose words of destruction may actually prevent that destruction from coming, we may see now that the false prophets are those who deny the Creator's universal laws of impermanence and karmic returns, by speaking words that encourage humanity to continue on with their proud and selfish ways. A distinction made clear by the prophets themselves, who, speaking for the Creator, have said, "For all high and low are out for ill-gotten gain. Prophets and priests are frauds, every one of them. They dress my people's wound, but on the surface only, saying all is well." All is well? Nothing is well. They ought to be ashamed because they have practiced abominations, yet they have no sense of shame. Therefore they will fall with a great crash and be brought to the ground on the day of reckoning. Do not listen to what is prophesied to you by the prophets who buoy you up with false hopes. They give voice to their own fancies. It is not the Lord's words they speak. They say to those who spurn the word of the Lord, "Prosperity will be yours." And to all who follow their stubborn hearts, they say, "No harm will befall you." For which of them has stood in the counsel of the Lord, has been aware of his word and listened to it? Which of them has heeded his word and obeyed it? In days to come you will truly understand, "I did not send these prophets, yet they went in haste. I did not speak to them, yet they prophesied. But if they had stood in my counsel, they would have proclaimed my words to my people and turned them from their selfish ways and their hurtful doings." Thus we may see that it is the role of the prophets, seekers and sages of our time, to serve as the watchmen for humanity. This they do by seeking peace along the ancient paths, so that in so finding they may then signal the way for others. However, those who would consider themselves watchmen must be careful in their work. For one who speaks falsely and leads the others astray will, in accordance with the law of karmic returns, be held responsible for their folly, as will one who has been shown the way but who chooses not to light the way for others. For this is the word of the Creator that was given to the prophet Ezekiel. When enemy forces move against a land, its people choose one of themselves to be their watchman. And if he sees the enemy approach, he blows his trumpet to warn the people. If anyone does not heed the warning and is overtaken by the sword, his fate be on his own head. He ignored the alarm when he heard it. Had he taken heed, he would have escaped with his life. But if the watchman does not blow his trumpet to give warning when he sees the approach of the enemy, and if anyone who is killed is caught with his sins on him, I shall hold the watchman answerable for his death. Yet it is essential to understand here that one who would serve as watchman must not do so to save himself. For the work one does for their own gain, no matter the benefit to others, does not count for them on the spirit side of life. Therefore, let your work be guided by love and wisdom and the will that others will find the way. And so, for those who see the signs and who hear the call, let us raise our voices together to tell the world that Armageddon is upon us, and it is a war that can only be won within. With our heads bowed and our hearts to heaven, let us give humble thanks to the Creator for blessing us with our lives and deaths, for our teachers and the teachings. Let us give thanks for all living things, and for the heavens and the earth, fire, water, and wind. Let us also give thanks for our families, friends, and foes, and for all that they teach us of peace, love, and forgiveness. Let us not look outside of ourselves for blame, but rather let us accept the part that we have all played in making this world what it is. And let us not pray to change the fate that is given to us in accordance with our actions, but rather let us humble ourselves and acknowledge that we are always given what we deserve. And therefore let us pray instead for the strength and the grace to bear the hardships whatsoever they may be, with the understanding that every end has its end, bringing with it a new beginning. Amen.